All right, everybody, Sylvia here, and today I want to do a video about cycle touring, give you guys some ideas for where to go for good information with or without electric assist so that you can be confident and have a successful tour.
Come on, Myrtle, let's go.
All right, yeah, so I'm coming to you from the dining room of the house where I'm staying in Portland, Oregon, and I wanted to do a video about cycle touring. I am motivated because I am seeing a lot of people post questions on Facebook. It seems because of COVID, people put off doing their tours. People are looking to maybe next summer, the summer after, and they are posting a lot of questions to get information about nitty gritty details about gear and routes. And I really want to caution people about asking for information on Facebook. There's a number of reasons for this, but probably the biggest reason is you just don't know who is responding. You don't know how old they are. You don't know what kind of experience they have. You don't know what kind of gear they used. And probably the bigger issue is people can only talk from their own experience from the gear that they used. And they're only going to have experience with whatever gear that they used. And almost unanimously, people love whatever gear that they have, whatever bike they have, whatever trike they have, whatever they used for their touring, they love it. But they don't have any experience with any other kind of gear or bike or trike. And so, you know, they're giving you information which may not be the best for what it is that you want to do. And so I want to give you some ideas for other places to go to get more reliable information that is kind of can talk to you from your perspective. I'm going to talk first about my experience. Like, why would you want to listen to me? What kind of experience do I have? So I have a lot of experience with cycle touring. I have cycle toured for 13 years solo all over the world on my tricycle. I have been on 6 continents in over 20 countries. I have cycle toured tens of thousands of miles. And I'll tell you how I got into this. To be honest, I don't even remember where I first heard about cycle touring. I just know that when the idea came into my head, I just became obsessed. It was like claws, you know, claws got into me and it would just not leave. And I probably researched and read about cycle touring for a couple of years before I actually started the tour. In fact, I think I was reading about cycle touring for over a year when I suddenly just said, you know, if this is just continuing to grab me so strongly, why not do it? Okay, let's go. Let's do this thing. And this was probably in 2004. There really wasn't much to the internet at that point. I got my information from reading books. And there are two authors that had a very big influence on me. The first one was Ann Musto. She has written a lot of books. And I will say that probably her first book, called simply A Bike Ride, had the biggest impact on me. Ann Musto was an older woman. She was a headmistress at a boarding school in England. Her husband had died. Her children were grown. And she came to this idea while on a bus tour traveling in Egypt. And she saw a guy riding his bike, traveling by bike out the bus window. And right then and there, she just said, that's what I want to do. And so the book goes through her whole evolution of how she came about doing this. She was an older woman. She was not athletic. She didn't even own a bicycle when the idea came to her. It was a wonderful book for me to read as an older woman who had never done any kind of touring before. And I read these books thinking, my gosh, if this woman can do it, certainly I can too. And then there was another book that was just fantastic. I think it is to this day still the best touring book I have ever read. It's written by Barbara Savage. It's called Miles from Nowhere. She and her husband did a tour around the world, and this book is just really well written and incredibly entertaining, and I highly, highly recommend it. And while I was reading these books, I was also learning about recumbent bikes, and I had bought myself a Fold Rush, which is the folding version of the Gold Rush bike, and I learned about a group of local guys who were riding across the United States together. They had a journal on a website called Crazy Guy on a Bike. I think they called themselves the Seven Warriors. And oh my gosh, it was so much fun to follow. These guys would put up a journal posting pretty much for every day that they rode. And so you felt like you were watching them, you were kind of with them as they rode across the United States and reading in real time. I learned about Crazy Guy on a Bike, which is an amazing resource. I think it's been around since 2003. When I first started touring, my first tour, I started in Portland and I went up to Canada. I turned around, not really knowing where I was going. I ended up in Guatemala and I spent 6 months in Mexico. And the first 3 years of my touring experience is on this blog. I'm going to tell you that aside from Crazy Guy on a Bike, there are all kinds of blogs for anywhere you could ever imagine doing a bike ride. All you have to do is type in the search engine where you want to go, that you want to cycle tour, and a ton of journals will come up. The last tour that I did was in Colombia. I spent 6 months riding around Colombia, and I was really worried. It's incredibly mountainous, and I was worried about being able to find a place to stay along the way. And I found a journal where the guy not only gave you his route and the number of miles and the elevation, but he told me every hotel that he stayed in. And this was particularly helpful. I started in Bogota, and I went through this incredibly mountainous area, and then it went down to the coast. And I knew as soon as I got to the coast, it was going to be really touristic, and I wouldn't have to worry about finding a place to stay. But in the mountains, I was like, oh my gosh, I have no idea. This guy's journal gave me all the information that I needed. And that is where these journals really come in handy, is it just doesn't matter like where you want to go or what kind of bike or what kind of gear, somebody's writing about it and you can get all of that information. You do not have to reinvent the wheel. Then of course there's YouTube. So the last few years, YouTube has really become popular. And I can tell you that the last two tours I did, the one in Colombia, and then the one before that, I did a tour from Cancun. I did a big circle from Mexico through Belize, Guatemala, and then back to Cancun, visiting as many Mayan ruin sites as I could. And on those tours, I did blogs where I wrote a daily description of every ride. And on the written blogs, you will find a route map, GPS, and I'll tell you where I started, where I ended, how many miles, and then give you a lot of pictures and kind of go into more of the emotional ups and downs that happen throughout the day. Whereas with the vlogs, it's more of a snapshot, and you know, you can't really make really long videos, and so it's more just kind of a snapshot, just a short little video about the day's ride. But I think between the two of them, it really gives you a lot of information. So other than that, the other really great resource, particularly for cycling in the United States, is adventure cycling. Association. So they have maps for routes all over the United States. On my first tour, I rode from Canada to Mexico using the maps from Adventure Cycling Association. And I can pretty confidently say without those maps, I'm not really sure I would have been able to start. They give you every bit of information that you could possibly need as a touring cyclist. So they tell you where all the campgrounds are. They tell you the hotels. They give you mileage. They tell you the grocery stores, post office, you know, any kind of medical information that you need. And probably for me, the most important information that they give you is elevation profile. And this is very, very important that you become aware of how much climbing you are going to do during a day. And before you start your tour, you need to know what kind of climbing you are comfortable doing. So I can talk about one of the most popular routes and absolute world-class touring. It's probably the route that I would recommend to anybody thinking about doing cycle touring, and that is the Pacific Coast Route. It goes from Canada to Mexico through Washington, Oregon, and California. It is a very challenging route. There's 100,000 feet of climbing on this route, and using the Adventure Cycling maps, you can see how much elevation you're going to be climbing on a day's route. And one of the things that I highly recommend for anybody thinking about doing cycle touring is that you become very comfortable with how much climbing you can do in a day. Personally, I am an extremely slow cyclist, and I know from experience that I am comfortable at the most 3,500 feet of climbing. And on this Pacific Coast route, it's not unusual to have days that are 3,500 feet of climbing. And so there's a couple of reasons why you want to know how much climbing you can do, because it's going to determine how far you can ride in a day. It's the climbing that is going to slow you down, and it's the climbing that's going to take the most time for the ride that you do in a day. And so you need to be able to say, how many miles and then how much climbing there is. Every single day that you ride, there's really only one objective, and that is to get to a safe place to spend the night. Everything you do during the day is to achieve that objective. So first of all, you need to know if you are comfortable camping, right? You need to know not only camping in campgrounds, but are you comfortable stealth camping, which is camping anywhere? And I know people who cycle tour, and part of their deal is they never pay for accommodation, and they can camp anywhere. Personally, I cannot do that. I do not feel safe, and I will not sleep if I don't feel safe. And so this is a piece of information that I have that I know I have to get someplace bona fide, like a campground, warm shower host, a hotel. And on this Pacific Coast route, it's the Pacific Coast, it's very touristic, and if you want to stay in hotels, you're looking at least $100 a night. There's also a lot of campgrounds, and one of the greatest things about this route is almost all of these campgrounds have what are called hiker biker sites. And if you hike or bike into these campgrounds, there is an area set aside for you to set up your tent. You cannot be turned away. They have to find you a spot. And these campgrounds, typically a site to stay there is about $7 a night. So it's very economical. In fact, I would say that this Pacific Coast route is one of the most economical ways to cycle tour and be safe. you've always got a safe place to spend the night. Now, you know, you can do these cycle tours in a number of ways, you know, a bicycle, a tricycle, with electric assist, without electric assist, and knowing how much elevation there is on the route becomes even more important if you're going to be using electric assist. If you are doing electric assist, then I really recommend that you go up and down hills until your battery runs out, because ideally, you know, what would be really great, what I did on my last tour, which I used electric assist going from Portland to Berkeley, almost every day I was able to use one battery. And because I knew how much climbing I could do during a day, I knew how I could set up my ride for the day. So for instance, I didn't want to go especially fast. I mean, my climbing speed without electric assist is 2.5-3 miles an hour. With electric assist, I really just wanted to go 5 to 8 miles an hour. And so I was able to go 40, 45 miles, 3,500 feet of climbing, averaging 10 to 12 miles an hour on one battery. And I really recommend to anybody that wants to do a tour with electric assist that you become familiar with that information. I also think that information is really helpful even if you're not using electric assist. If you are using electric assist and you're going down the Pacific Coast and you get to some of these hiker biker sites, they don't have electricity, and so you're gonna need to figure out how to charge up your batteries. You can charge up on the way. Maybe you're gonna take a break for lunch for an hour, and you can bring your battery into the restaurant, but you're probably only gonna be there for an hour, so maybe you'll get an extra bar of juice. At the end of the day, you're still gonna need to charge up your battery, and this is where the camp host and RV people will be a big, big help. Some of these campgrounds, even the RV sites, don't have electricity, but the camp host sites always have electricity. And their job is to make sure everybody is taken care of. You know, they're the local resource. And on the outside of all RVs, there are two outlets. And I have never had a camp host deny me. It's like, not a problem. Just go plug in, leave your batteries sitting outside this, the camp host's RV. You know, maybe it'll take 5 hours to charge up. But the other thing that's really nice is because it's on the outside of the RV, you don't have to interrupt the camp host when you go back to go get your battery after it's charged. If you are somebody who really likes to go fast and you're gonna end up bringing two batteries and probably going through those batteries, bring two chargers and you'll be able to charge both of them at the same time, and then your batteries will be ready for the next day. So that's my talk for the day about cycle touring, to give you guys some ideas for where to go for really good information and some things you should become familiar with before you start your tour. So let me know. I'm sure I left out a lot of stuff, and maybe this video is kind of long, and let me know. I mean, I can do a lot of different cycle touring videos. I don't know why I'm kind of shy about it, but I saw these people posting on Facebook and I thought, oh my gosh, they need better information. So this is my way of helping out and participating. Let me know what you think. Leave a comment in the comment section below. I love hearing from everybody. Please stay safe, stay healthy, and I'll see you in the next video.